workers turned their backs on the 19th century values and pushed forward on their professional road, claiming the virtues of universal equality between men and women. By the mid-1950s, according to Professor Drachman and other scholars, regardless of the path they chose, women lawyers understood they were far from equal in the profession. Now that background is crucial in understanding what I consider the nearer past, it's nearer to me, and not nearer to you, of the 1950s and 60s, and onward, my past, because it underscores the depth and longevity of the problem of integrating women into the practice. In a nutshell, despite our belief at the end of the 19th century that we could achieve the momentum and the goal that was necessary with the passage of time, by the 1950s, the status quo for women in the practice had changed a little. In her mind travel lecture, reflecting on her life in the law, my dear friend and mentor Sylvia Pressler recounted her own experiences in the 50s. She said, our class started with five women, only two of whom were left by Thanksgiving. She went on to tell us that when I joined the Bergen County Bar Association, I was instructed that its few women members did not attend its annual dinner. I went anyway. A court reporter complained that her voice was too high and he could not follow her. And when she was first appointed to what was then the county court, she joined only four other women judges throughout the entire state of New Jersey. Now, I would like to say that in the eight or so years that separated us, the promise of equality took on new life, but that is not the case. In 1963, I went to Rutgers Law School directly out of college. I always disabuse the audience of their notions of the 60s. Mine were not the 60s that you see on television. So, I actually never saw a psychedelic band. My 60s was just a spillover of the 50s in which my generation was rooted. To put things in context, in 1960, 6% of the doctors were women, 3% of lawyers, 1% of engineers. A medical school dean actually said outright that a quota system was in operation. Yes, indeed, he said, we do take women. We take one. And because we don't want her to be lonely, we usually take two. In 1961, out of the 454 federal civil service titles for college graduates, 200 were male only. Sociologist David Griesman commented, instead of contemplating high-powered careers in finance or architecture or law or medicine, the brightest young women were satisfied to assume positions with glamorous names and low pay, like UN guide or stewardess or publisher's assistant, with absolutely no hope of advancement. At that time, the highest female judge in the country was in the Customs Court, and United Airlines still had men-only executive flight. That is important because it describes the very profession that we entered in the 60s, buttoned down and buttoned up. We were known as the breakthrough class at Rutgers Law School, 12 women admitted out of about 150 first-year students. Four of us eventually graduated. It was just an experiment. Never before had women been admitted to law school in such numbers, and the two classes ahead of mine had only three women out of 300 students. But nothing much changed after the so-called breakthrough, except that we were there. We loved law school. Nevertheless, some of our classmates and professors felt free to say things like, it's a shame that people like you, who will never really practice and will give up law to raise families, are taking up the place of breadwinners. Now, that incidentally was a universal experience. Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg reports that she had the same thing happen when the dean of her law school and an orientation get-together at his house. He said, what are you doing here? I make these points to show that, as it turned out, although Rutgers may have been in the vanguard, things were buttoned up inside the law schools to prepare us for the world outside. A Harvard Law Review survey of 1963 reported that women were among the least wanted recruits in firms of every size and specialty, regardless of their law school performance. One reason for this was because of the stereotypic thinking about women quitting to get married. Another was the perception that a woman could not be an all-around associate because she could not go to court successfully. That perception, in turn, was informed by two other ideas, that women could not handle themselves in the rough and tumble atmosphere of the courtroom, and that juries would not like them. That necessarily limited their potential in firms. Clerkships were nearly impossible to come by. Several judges came right out during interviews and rejected the notion of totally professional relationships. They said to us, my wife would not like it if we worked closely together. Of course, later on, a couple of judges ran away with their female clerks, playing right into the stereotype. Sue Simmons went to the newly minted public defender's office. And the notion that public service was a good place for women turned out to be true. As a result, we were the first women thrust into the courtroom on a daily basis. And that is the good news. Here's the bad news. Our presence in the courtroom revealed an attitude not much different from that experienced by the first women at the bar a half a century earlier. In one early court appearance, I always tell this story because I still can't believe it, my adversary challenged my very right to represent the state of New Jersey. When the judge asked why, he said, "I don't know, but I know this cannot be right." the rest of the lawyers kind of snickered. Cynthia Jacob, now a well-known employment lawyer, always used her maiden name, although she is married. She was taken to task by a judge who said she was trying to pass herself off as a virginal unmarried woman before a jury. Our adversaries always called us lovely, beautiful, the lovely attorney general, the gorgeous public defender. Judges and lawyers called us honey and dearie and missy, which for some reason, maybe a generational thing, was rather common. A public defender was told by one judge during a trial in open court that every time he saw her, this was before the jury, he was reminded of Shirley Temple on the Good Chinois. When one female attorney was asked by a federal judge if she was Miss or Mrs., she said Ms. and was castigated again in front of the jury. The judge said, "There'll be no Ms. in my courtroom." When I did a stint at the Essex County Prosecutor's Office in 1968, a judge actually complained to the prosecutor that I was wearing patterned stockings. Now, come on, we're not talking about the American flag here. This was herringbone. And he thought that this, and why he was looking at my stockings, I don't know. The judge of office rarely got through a court proceeding without a reference on the record to her beautiful red hair and her beautiful blue eyes, and was always initially directed to the reporter's seat. When Sylvia Pressler ultimately became a judge and very quickly was elevated to the appellate division, you might think things were different, but she regaled us with the story of sitting with two male judges in a case involving an injury resulting from electrical arcing between two junction boxes. The lawyer stood up and actually began his argument by saying, "I'm sure that at least two members of the panel will understand this case." And he wasn't talking about Sylvia. The coda to that story is that when Sylvia went to dinner at the home of one of the other judges on the panel, there was a power failure, and she was the only one who knew what to do with it. To be sure, this is anecdotal material, but those anecdotes were not the exception, they were the rule. Comments about how we looked and dressed were made by judges, adversaries, court attendants, and even clients who sensed this was okay. Given the amazing success of the women lawyers of the 60s, those anecdotes seem funny. But every sociologist and psychologist who has studied this material has concluded that it wasn't funny at all, and that it had the effect of slowly altering the angle of repose in the courtroom to the detriment of women lawyers. Perhaps more pernicious was that any overt sign of intensity or ambition in or out of court on the part of a woman lawyer was judged and in fact declared unseemly. Characteristics valued in a male adversary, for example, determined pursuit of his client's interests, was denigrated as too aggressive and too pushy in a woman, and unfortunately, to some extent, that remains the case. Much worse, we were in truth pitted against each other, because it was the consensus of contemporary wisdom that there would never be room, for example, for more than one female judge in any vicinage, or if you braved private practice, there would never be room for more than one woman partner in any firm. Women actually relocated when another woman in the vicinage was named to the bench. Obviously, because so few were named, not many had to move. If one woman was made a partner in the firm, and that was as unique as a lightning strike, the others looked for a new place to land. I would love to say that we faced this scourge now and confronted it directly at every turn, but for most of us, it wasn't the truth. And it wasn't only us. When Nora Ephron applied for a writing job at Newsweek after graduating from Vassar, she was told, "Women don't become writers here." And as she put it, "It would never, ever, ever have crossed my mind to say, how dare you." On Wall Street, Ivy educated women lawyers said nothing when law firms inquired about their typing skills. But because we were young and resilient and ambitious and confident, because we simply understood this to be part of the territory, and because in our hearts, we truly believed, as they had that as the years went on and more women came into the profession and we reached a critical mass, things would change, we grinned and bore it. And we struggled to make our names on our merits by just outworking everyone else. Mostly we were successful, and we rode the wave of enthusiasm of others to appoint the first woman this and the first woman that. What is so amazing is that while we were laboring outside our homes in the courtrooms, holding up not just our own personal honor, but that of all women, and there was definitely a sense that any misstep would resonate negatively beyond the person who made the misstep, we were also laboring at home, and I mean laboring. It was in the early days of feminism, and I believe there is still a residue of it now, that the so-called mommy wars began. There was an unspoken and sometimes spoken rivalry between stay-at-home moms and working moms. For example, my daughter and son went to schools where the other mothers did not work. When we started kindergarten in 1983, notice I said we, some psychologists would tell me that is reflective of inadequate personal boundaries. I was frozen out of the inner circle. The only person worse off than me in terms of being invited to join the other mothers was a lesbian couple, which of course was unheard of at the time, so we teamed up and carpool and socialized with our children. But because of that prejudice, working mothers, like me, felt compelled, rightly or wrongly, to have homemade Halloween costumes for their children. And on Teacher Appreciation Day, our contributions had to be cakes from scratch or homemade cookies. We could never bring anything from Dunkin' Donuts. That way, we could maintain our status as real mothers and real women. Our dinner parties were never catered. Each one was a cooking frenzy, a tour de force, a feverish race against time to bake the bread from our own sourdough starter, stuff the sauce in the work all day on Julia Child's cocoa bath, hand-print the place cards, and flambé the dessert so that no one could ever say that we didn't stack up.
Matrimonial lawyers came in on holidays during
It was the life we all wanted. Fast forward now to 1981, when the subject of gender bias in the boards was first raised by the by national organizations. It was met universally with sneers and denials by male lawyers, judges, and court administrators. Because those denials could not be countered with anecdotes, a call went out for state-specific information. And it was Judge Marilyn Loftus, who had been a trailblazer for women in state government, who answered that call. In response, Chief Justice Valence created the New Jersey Supreme Court Task Force on Women in the Courts, chaired by Judge Loftus, to investigate not whether gender bias existed in New Jersey, but its extent and impact. Now that might sound like ancient history to you, but we actually lived it. The Chief Justice asked us to investigate the nature and extent of the gender differential in the courts, and more particularly, how gender affects the treatment of women and men in the legal and judicial environment. Over 800 male and female lawyers responded to our initial survey. 1,100 responded in regional and state meetings. Judge Loftus spearheaded the task force, and we each took turns representing it, often being treated rather disgracefully with booze and raspberries at local bar meetings. These were not local bar, this is bar meetings. Males and females, as might be expected, have very different perceptions of the status of women in the legal and judicial environment. Women reported observing differential treatment more often than was observed by men. Now, without reiterating all the conclusions reached by the task force, which I know you're familiar with, as to the continued existence of an engendered atmosphere in the courtroom, I want to just give you a couple of examples of responses to the 1983 survey. Keep in mind that this survey took place 8 decades after women first began being admitted to practice and 17 full years after my class, the class of 66, hopefully walked onto the stage at the War Memorial Building, wearing a hat and gloves, incidentally, with more women than ever joining the ranks of the bar. That year, there were 6 of us out of the 300 who were sworn in. Listen to these words. I am often referred to as Marie in court. During a court proceeding by a judge, immediately I am perceived as less commanding of respect and importance as a 39-year-old female. The most disturbing thing that I am sure that many of these incidents, such as a judge calling an attorney pretty or dear, are viewed as totally harmless. Female attorneys are loath to appear discourteous to a judge who thinks he is complimenting them, especially if she thinks it's going to hurt her client. Another one said this. Judge X totally humiliated me at the calendar call when he said, in front of everybody, and I don't know if the calendar call is like it used to be, but it used to be that everybody was called in on Friday for calendar call. The room was packed, jammed. The lawyers were lined up around the outside. Every seat was taken. And he says from the bench, you get better looking every time I see you. How come I didn't hire you when you applied for that clerkship? The other men guffawed freely since I was the only woman in the room. I'm sure they thought I was a poor sport for fighting back tears of rage instead of being able to take such a compliment. In response to a statement by a female attorney that she had problems with her case, the judge made the pronouncement in front of everybody again, women are the problem, and people in the audience were clapping. The final anecdote is this, and this was still one of my favorites, and it was, the woman says, I participated in a conference with my male adversary and a male judge in a custody matter. I thought they were going to pass around the brandy and cigars. They made remarks like, I like my women to be women. I truly believe the judge was prejudiced against me and my female client. We presented the report of the task force at the 1983 Judicial College to all of the assembled judges who were literally forced by Chief Justice Valence to sit through the presentation. He said, anyone who gets up and leaves during this presentation, which some of the judges had threatened to do, will be in trouble. It was not a happy audience, as you might expect, and only the quality of the report, the constituency of the task force, and the commitment of Chief Justice Valence to zero tolerance for gender bias kept the judges in their seats, but they told us what they thought in the bar afterwards. Whatever they thought, the task force made history. It was replicated throughout the nation. 42 states and 8 federal circuits undertook studies of their own, and for the first time through education and sensitization, the problem began to remediate itself. It no longer was part of the territory to be subjected to subtle and not so subtle remarks based on gender. The committee later revisited the issue with new surveys, and in a nutshell, they reported that the situation has improved dramatically since the original task force, with some work still to be done, and I think that's pretty accurate. The world in which women practice today is qualitatively different from the one into which I came in 1966. There are three women on the United States Supreme Court, three on the New Jersey Supreme Court. On October 1st, Mary Kate Cuff will make that number four. My last year, there were five of us, the four women, including me, and Dorothea Weffing, who was temporarily assigned. In 2011, women made up 47% of the law school classes and are beginning to be represented in greater numbers in the courtroom. The bench is changing to reflect this as well. In 1984, only 3.3% of judges were women. Now, roughly, it's 33%, which is, again, roughly reflective of the overall percent of women to men admitted 10 years. Partnerships and leadership positions in private practice have been on a slow but steady incline. 51% of all judicial law clerks are women. Women appear in high numbers in appellate arguments and represent every segment of the litigating population, often extremely successfully, and they give as good as they get in the trenches of the courtroom. From that perspective, I believe we are at the point that our sisters imagined in 1900. As the latest task force reports, if attention is paid, we have no reason to expect anything other than continued improvement in the status of women in the 21st century. Thus, I think it would be fair to say that it's unlikely that any of you will experience the wholly adverse effects of the highly engendered legal system as it existed in the 19th century or even in the 1950s and the 1960s. That is not to say, however, that you will not experience during the 21st century some equally intractable problems. What you should take from our experience is that the women who went before you were not embittered or defeated by their unwilling hosts. They persevered, were energized by the opposition, energized the system which had originally sought to exclude them. Thus, your challenge is not to live a life of cynicism and suspicion, but to bring that optimism and determination to the tasks, distinct but equally difficult, which will surely face you as movers and shakers in the new century. Primary among those issues is the problem of work-life balance, which continues to dog women in all professions. I wish I had an easy answer, but I don't. Juggling the life of a wife, a mother, a daughter, a high-powered career is never going to be easy. Optimism and determination are only going to carry you so far. You have to make choices about what tasks you will devote your energies to, and you need to say no to some worthy ventures, to seek help if you require it, and even more fundamentally, to decide both professionally and personally how you want to live your life. A great career will never make up for an unhappy home or miserable children. Likewise, a happy home will not fully ameliorate a legal career that you dread getting out of bed every day to pursue. Which brings me to having it all. Now, at a Wellesley graduation, the late Nora Ephron, who I adored, so this is my second reference to her in this presentation, said this: "This is the season when a clutch of successful women who have it all give speeches to women like you and say, to be perfectly honest, you can't have it all. Maybe young women don't wonder whether they can have it all any longer, but in case any of you are wondering," Miss Ephron said, "of course you can have it all. It will be a little messy, but embrace the mess. It will be complicated, but rejoice in the complications." And she repeated, "Did I say it was hard? Yes, but let me say it again, so that none of you can ever say that nobody told me it was hard. But it is also incredibly interesting. You are so lucky to have that life as an option." As a counterpoint to that, recently, Professor Anne-Marie Slaughter of Princeton University wrote an article, the thesis of which is that women still can't have it all because the home work struggle remains impossible. So you see the two different views. Sally Quinn recently sided with Nora Ephron's valedictory in an op-ed piece in the Washington Post, in which she said this: "It is time to stop whining and moaning about how we can't have it all or boasting that we can. The point is, we can have the lives we want." struggle to balance your personal and professional lives is not unique but universal, that others who have gone before you have survived and even flourished, and that you have the power within you to do the same. Do not be taken in by the hype that women are leaving the profession in droves. It is true, they are leaving the profession, but a recent Harvard Business Review survey tells us that 93% of the women who have left eventually want to return. This is a great profession, but you need to participate in your own future by choosing the things that make up your all. Last but not least, whatever you determine your all to be, one rule governs and it always will. Do the very best work possible. Nothing takes the place of it, not genius, not heart. If your work